Okay, on the show today, the one, the only, the fabulous Ruby Wax. So British listeners will definitely know who she is. She was trained in theatre and she was Shakespearean. It's probably best known for some of her work in television, things like Absolutely Fabulous and many, many shows, some of which I don't want to make her feel old, but I grew up with. I have to say, of all the sort of speakers we had at the Embodiment Conference, it was the one that made my mum jump up and say, "Oh, you've got Ruby Wax on. Oh, what's she like?" So she's lovely. And I said, what you might not know, Mum, is she's done a lot of stuff on mental health. So Ruby has not only an OBE, but I believe a master's in mindfulness, has been teaching mindfulness for a while, really made a lot of progress, I think, in British culture for people feeling less stigmatized around mental health. I spoke to my sister at the weekend and she just said, tell Ruby thank you. She saw
Oh,
one of your
wow.
shows, I think, around Frazzled a few years ago. And it was kind of very critical for her to be more honest and open about mental health issues in our family. Recently saw her show, her new show in Froom, which is a lot of fun. And it was really interesting, Ruby, hearing you kind of talk about things like meditation retreats and EMDR and seeing an audience of people who were some of them were clearly kind of new to that stuff and making people feel like, hey, mental health is something we can talk about. So, long intro, I think you deserve it. Welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Let's hear a bit about your own life. What is it sort of biographically, what in your own life got you interested in the work you do now with mindfulness and mental health?
Well, first of all, that show, I'm Not as Well as I Thought I Was, isn't really about mindfulness, it's not to contradict you, or really mental health. It's about somebody who, during COVID, felt like they weren't getting enough attention. It's kind of me and it kind of isn't me. So I decided, let's call it me, to go on these journeys to find meaning, to get some depth, because I found myself too shallow. So I go on a 30-day silent retreat. I go swimming with humpbacks to follow their trail up to Norway. I go to work in a refugee camp. I try to get people out of Afghanistan. I do things not in the name of mental health, but sort of what everybody wants to do is find. What the whole, they want to find faith. That's why I went to a Christian monastery or compassion or whatever. They just want to get off the same old. So that's what I did. I happened to get another bout of mental illness after about 6 months. And that I didn't do it on purpose, but the book became more interesting because one was a journey out to find meaning and one was a journey in to find out why I was running so hard. So it became inner and outer. And it was, I don't write about it. It just, I happened to have depression. Otherwise, the book would have just been a travelogue, but with depth.
And it's
And
strange.
the show, but it ends up, you go down deep into the psyche and way out again.
It's
I
strange.
take you on journeys.
There's these sort of two things that people are very interested in at the moment. One is there's the meaning crisis, it's as be called. People are saying, what's the point of it all? People are looking in different directions for that. And the other one is the mental health crisis. Like we are at a time when more and more people are having issues. Today I was with a friend of mine whose child came to meditate with us because she's having anxiety. We meditate in the mornings together and he brought his 10-year-old today. And that's just sort of not surprising to me at the moment. It does seem like mental health is really on the radar for a lot of people right now.
Well, it's one. It was 1 in 4. Now it's 1 in 3 for kids, and there aren't enough shrinks to go around. And good luck finding any bed if you need to be in an institution. So that's why I think mindfulness is so popular because it is a way of regulating the cortisol. Cooling down your mind before it flips, and but you have to have the discipline to do it. And we're living in a culture where it's entitlement. Why should I try anything? It should come to me. So it's a kind of conundrum as to you actually have anything you learn, like piano or tennis. There were times when it was pathetic. So same with mindfulness. You start at the base camp and then work your way up. Do you do mindfulness with people online or do they come over?
I do both. So I do mindfulness in nature, mindfulness sitting in a classroom, and mindfulness on Zoom.
All right.
Embodiment involves mindfulness, so it's a pretty key part of it. I just re-listened to your book Frazzled actually to prep for the interview, and you've got lots of sort of good practical exercises in there. And you do make the point of like, hey, I know this might be a bit what the cool kids would call cringe, but you need to do it. You need to do the reps. You need to build this as a skill.
A muscle. Yeah. Also, with the blessing of the guy who created it, which was my professor at Oxford, where that's where I got my master's, is I showed a way of practicing it. But like when you're in the car, when you're drinking coffee, when you're in the shower, when your kids are screaming. So mindfulness isn't something that you have to go sit on a gluten-free cushion with your eyes rolled back. It's something you can, it's like going to the, why go to the gym when you've got a handbag and you can just lift it and lower it and lift it and lower it, especially if you put a lot of oranges in it. You actually don't have to go to a gym to work out. I mean, unless you want to be a, you know, one of those athletes. But mindfulness you can do everywhere because the gym is your brain.
What do you find as some of the useful frames or things to avoid when presenting it to a kind of fairly conventional audience? So, many people listen to this, they're sort of diehard yoga meditation people, but when they then try and bring that to, say, a business group or to a group of, I don't know, stressed single mums or whoever it is, there's mistakes that can be made. So what have you found useful in making it
I
accessible?
do a lot of talks for businesses, but because I studied the science, they love that. I don't go all fluffy on them and say it's just about feeling good or this is a way to, you know, to be present and find instant happiness. Go call Eckhart Tolle. But I talk about the science and what the exercise of mindfulness is. Even though you can't see it, it's exactly like getting a six pack. You're playing with something in your brain that bulks up your insulin, your ACC, and all these parts. So I don't make the mistake of going fluffy on people. I think that men especially love that I can give them why mindfulness. It happened to be have the most empirical evidence of success with depression, bipolar, certain ADHD, PTSD. Just being generally frazzled. Other things I'm sure came in second, but the reason I studied mindfulness was it came in first.
And there's a whole chapter, isn't there, in Frazzled on the sort of science base, and I think for a lot of people that is appealing. You made this distinction between frazzled, which is a very British word, so you should probably explain it to some of our international audience.
Well, no, it's a neurobiological word. It means stressed about stress. So we're supposed to be stressed. You know, that's our gives us our mojo. And my whole show is about the difference between being stressed, which we need. Otherwise, we wouldn't progress. We'd still be on all fours. My whole show is about that, not this new one. This new one is much better. Can I say the name? I'm Not As Well As I Thought I Was, which is now I'm performing on tour. And the book just came out. So Frazzled was many years ago. But I do discuss in Frazzled the difference between this new phenomena, which is why am I so stressed? Nobody else is stressed. I must be a loser. I'm not good enough. That's a new phenomena. So it's like we're sabotaging ourselves with our own thinking. That's new. That's why this culture is getting ill.
The culture's ill, and I've heard you made this point on an interview you did not long ago that it's not just like, hey, if everyone learns a bit of mindfulness, that will be the solution, right? Like, there's a bigger cultural sickness at work here, and there's aspects of that that seem to have hit a kind of critical mass, even just in the last 2 or 3 years.
Say what you said again. What's the question?
So it's just a reflection that the
Said.
culture itself is has conditions which mean that people are more stressed than our evolutionary ancestors were, even
Yes.
if they're sort of running around, being chased by tigers and things.
Well, because the alarm system doesn't can't tell if something's behind you, the part of the brain that goes into high alarm. Or something's happening 20,000 miles away. So if you watch the news, it'll scare the shit out of you because you don't just see the images once, it's on a loop. I think the producers are wanting to get you hysterical because then you'll watch even more television. And, but the brain sees an image, it doesn't know that it's not there. And it's that it's addictive because the adrenaline that rushes through you when you watch those images. And I always say, why don't people get addicted to kale? Why do they only get addicted to things that are bad for you?
And if social media companies want to keep us stressed for advertising, news people want to keep us stressed, I've heard you made that point to keep us watching. Maybe politicians want to keep us stressed so we, keep voting for them or whatever.
Well,
Like,
but that's
the
Trump.
we're
Trump's
in,
true.
right?
Yeah. He
Sorry.
scares the shit out of you. And so it's Trump. And so you think, oh, he's going to make things better. But you can't, you forget that he's the one making it so scary. Like I saw once a mother beating her kid on the train. And then the kid went to the mother for solace and she hugged him. And you thought, yeah, but she's the one who terrorized you.
I mean, I see politicians on all sides doing that, if I'm honest. I don't particularly see that to be limited to sort of one political party. They just try to scare you with different things. You know, the right tries to scare you with immigrants, and the left tries to scare you with other things. But it's like that is the context we're in. So sort of given that, how effective will a mindfulness program be that we are in this context of technology and politics and all these things happening? Is it enough, I guess, is the question I hear more and more raised in the last few years, even from people who are quite big advocates of meditation and yoga, for example.
Well, yoga is a growing industry, but then people associate it with wearing leotards that start, your liver, and then go over to your earlobes, and you can catapult out, some of your organs. I mean, yoga seems a very flashy little sport now, where you go in and forget that you get into your body, but you're competing with the 17-year-old to, tie your ankles in a
Very
bow.
gymnastic.
Whoa. But I think mindfulness is a harder concept because you don't see anything except the results in an MRI scanner. And I don't think people have that at home. I was hoping when I speak to Google that they'd make a mental Fitbit, because if you had something that said, okay, your cortisol's at 100%, you have a choice now. You either have a heart attack or you finish the work. I think that, the same way you have physical warnings. I think that would replace mindfulness, because all mindfulness is, but it's not all, but why I like it, it's a kind of barometer to see what your mental temperature is. It sort of tells you, for me, I'm going into depression. This is just anxiety. This is just fear. Just feel the fear rather than fear about the fear. It helps you drive the mind rather, like you're driving the car. So you can put the first turbo or just neutral instead of just being driven the whole time. I'm not great at it, but I'm better than I was.
So people like the wearables as well, don't they? They like to have some sort of objective
I
measure.
think that would be great. I think that would replace mindfulness.
I mean, there's HRV kind of measurables and aura
Yeah, but
sleep
it's all
rings.
bullshit so far.
There's nothing so far that you would rate as a measure.
No.
Measurable. Let's talk about the taboo of mental health then. So, I mean, in my lifetime, I've seen this change quite a lot. And you've been one of the people that's really been supportive of reducing the taboo of mental health. Why are you so passionate about that?
Well, I have mental health issues, and so I wish somebody like me would have said it's okay and come out and talk about it, because it's the only illness where shame is connected. You can have any organ go down and you wouldn't feel shame. Even cancer, where's the shame? But mental illness is something, because people think you're making it up, or they did. I think people are taking it really seriously now. But you don't commit suicide because you had a liver complaint. So, I think it's, to me, the mothership, neuroscience, that's where the money should go, because the brain is responsible for almost every disease going. So stop it. And, you can stop it at the source of the Nile. Stop the flood from then pushing you into diabetes 2, infertility, certain cancers, diabetes 2. Everything starts from the brain. Not everything, but certain diseases.
The case you make is sort of very sort of brain centric. You know, there's a and previously maybe people kind of had a very moralistic or sort of pseudo spiritual frame on these things, and calling mental health an illness is a huge step forward. So people are less judgmental about it. People address it like any other illness. You know, it's a very positive thing. What would you say to people like, I don't know, let's say Johann Hari, who did the book Lost Connections and very famous TED talk, saying that yes, mental health can have biological causes, but it's not just a brain condition because there are all these societal, cultural, you know, various other factors. It's not just a brain condition.
I don't really agree, because even the culture has an effect on your brain. Take away the word condition, is that we don't know the outside world. Unless you had a brain, it would just be a black hole. So I don't know what he's talking about. I like him, but that doesn't make sense. You don't have a disease like Alzheimer's because you were in a car crash. You don't have PTSD unless you had the genes for it. After 9/11, very few people had PTSD because they had community and they could speak to each other. So it's more complicated than that. But everything does happen because of the neural connections. There is nothing else. And
It's
obviously you have a lot of
brilliant.
neurons in the gut, but we don't even know about that.
Yeah, I mean the brain is always involved in that we always have a brain, right? But that's not the cause. That's how it happens, not why it happens.
Well, you could say the genes, but it still goes to the brain. It's not like your finger has mental illness. It is in the brain. Alzheimer's
Okay.
is in the brain. Schizophrenia is in the brain. Bipolar is in the brain. It's not in any other part of your body.
Right. All I'm saying is that it, you can't reduce it to a brain condition in many cases. There are conditions that have, Alzheimer's or something that has a very clear brain biological cause. But there's many other mental health conditions, let's take depression, that are hugely linked to socioeconomic status, life conditions.
No, I don't agree with you. I think it's nature and nurture. It's a
Sure,
disease
both.
and it's got nothing to, you can win an Oscar and still want to hang yourself. I have to disagree. I really think there's anxiety and there's neurosis and there's, narcissism, but depression is like schizophrenia is not because of the, your economic situation. And depression is on the level of schizophrenia.
Well, the stats on schizophrenia is that it's impacted by socioeconomic status.
You're
Not
talking
just,
to the wrong
it's
person.
partly genetic, but it's partly not genetic.
It's genetic and it's early experiences. I agree with you. But if yeah, I totally agree with you. I mean, it has to be ignited by nature too. But I think it's earlier in childhood. If my parents were particularly violent and I had the genes, then bingo, you'll probably get it.
Do you sometimes feel like you're carrying around dodgy genes that are waiting to be set off? I have a lot of mental ill health in my family, and I was actually talking to my wife about potentially having kids at one point, and we were sort of joking about it. She's like, "Wow, how many of your dodgy family genes is our kid gonna get?" And then it's, well, yeah, they might get the gene, but if we love them and treat them right, they might not get set off. So it's not just deterministic, right?
Or they might, nobody knows. Again, it's Russian roulette. The most adoring parents, and you've got, a wild card.
Yeah, I've seen that in alcoholism. I've seen a lot of people with more, there's more people in Alcoholics Anonymous with trauma than I think is typical, but there's other people that just had perfect, lovely childhoods and, just kind of really random. So there's definitely wild cards. Yeah. What do you think is the next frontier for this kind of mental health taboo? Because I feel like there's been a lot of progress that's been made. For example, like people talk about anxiety much more freely, but maybe
I
say
think
something.
it is the next taboo. I mean, it was you couldn't say cancer, then you couldn't say you were gay, and now it's mental. You couldn't even say you were a witch at one point. What's the next taboo? I don't know, because I guess sleeping with your pet.
No, I mean within mental health, because for example, I hear people talk about depression, but not schizophrenia very much. Like there's differences within mental health, isn't
Yeah.
there? What's
Well, a
more?
woman was crying yesterday. I do in the second half of my show, I do question and answer, and she was weeping because her son has schizophrenia, and he's been ostracized because people associate it with, criminals,
Yes, it's sort
knife.
of dangerous. Is the prejudice, right? That people are dangerous.
I agreed with her. That does have a bad rap.
Well, tell more about people's responses to it. There's some powerful moments in the show. What kind of responses do you get from people kind of after the show? I know sometimes you do discussions and things like that, don't you? So how do
I'm
people,
not as well as I thought I was, that
yeah,
show.
how does it land with people?
I think that most people go, thanks, because I sort of say what they were thinking. That's on, I'm being, I'm sort of obnoxious by saying that, but I mean, the point of doing the show is that I take you on a journey of who you are. And so they say in the second half, they ask questions, but they're really asking for themselves. I don't have the answers. If you wait around, they could figure it out. But if I can reflect back, then you're helping the situation. And we're talking about it, which really, it really relieves everybody. Because if you don't have mental illness, you're a caregiver. You know somebody with mental illness. So it affects the whole audience. And they talk
Everyone's
about
connected.
other things too. Not much, but
Are there sort of particular things that stand out or that burn in people's memory, do you think, from the show? Obviously, without ruining the whole thing for people ahead of seeing it. Are there sort of things that people consistently say that was a moment that really stuck with me?
well, there's more poignant moments, but I do take you swimming with humpbacks. And of course, I can't lie. I don't make it up, but I was with 12 12 good old American Yanks. Good old one guy was a professional exterminator, and then German healers that would tell me that the whales download their knowledge of the cosmos. So what happened on that journey was hilarious. So they do like they like the journey with the humpbacks, and they like when I go on a 30-day silent retreat.
Yes, the German energy healers definitely stand out. I've taught in Germany, and this is an archetype almost there.
So
And
I
I
had
think
to sing with whales. They made me sing. So I every night we had to sing with the whales.
I'm sure that was a wonderful, enriching experience, but
That's
why
what
not?
I'd
It's good
say
to
to
have
them. I'd
reminded.
say that's wonderful because I didn't know what else to say to them.
I went with a friend of mine, Danny, who both of us had done multiple silent retreats, and it was when you were talking about your inner dialogue while doing the washing up at the silent retreat,
Oh,
we were
was
both
that?
sort of laughing and looking at each other. That inner process from the retreat may be worth mentioning. I think that's a fun example of what you're bringing.
Well, the woman next to me, who was the dishwasher, was wanted me to say, "Oh my God, you're so enlightened," because she washes dishes very slowly, and I tried to wash them even slower to show her I was pretty enlightened too. And it took us till midnight because we were going so slow.
And there is a sort of affectation in the spiritual community of, for example, going slow or speaking in a certain voice.
Oh, I hate that voice.
You seem to sort of
That
cut through
stuff
that
is me.
bullshit quite fiercely, I think.
You always hear them, and there's a sunset, and they're very precious. It sounds like you're sending some yogurt through a sieve, or that when they start sentences with "so," and then using their hands to show their inner feel. There's so much crap in this. But I was saying, in my place, everything was. When you do 30-day silence, that's like the Iron Man of the brain. So you're not futzing around anymore. Nobody's speaking like this because nobody's speaking. Something does happen to your brain after 30 days. It can't help but do it. Either it makes you crazy and you run out screaming and say, "I gotta shop," or the thoughts eventually kind of lose the battle. They don't go away, but they sure get quiet because they're so exhausted from calling you an asshole.
Was that at Spirit Rock or IMS or
Spirit Rock.
Pleasant place. Yeah. What's next for you on your sort of journey of spirituality and meaning? What's your sort of latest
Well, I've
exploration?
done that book. I've done that book. I mean, I have a bucket list, and I've always been curious. But the difference between the I'm not as well as I thought I was. Well, because the shrink in the mental clinic made me tell my story, but without being funny, because I've always made my parents comp part of my comedy, because Alan Rickman used to say, "Just tell stories about your parents," because they were so nuts. So she made me cut the comedy, even though it just kept coming in whenever I was with her, almost spiting her. But she did make me say what happened in my life without being funny, and it was pretty horrific. So it was a cathartic ending. And I don't have to do it anymore. But I did figure out that I wasn't running toward anything. I was running away. And now when I go to places, there is a conclusion at the end of the book. I'm running out of curiosity. I'm not running because I'm haunted. I'm sure it's still there. If something terrible happened to you, you have scars. But unless you talk about them every day with your shrink, they get larger and larger. If you sort of learn to live with them and do mindfulness, going, "Yeah, there is pain, but I'm not in pain. There is anger, but I'm not in anger." Eventually, the scar tissue, it gets more and more minute. I really believe that. And so I still want to run. I still want to find, I'm curious, but I don't know what's next. And that's killing me.
Okay, so I'm gonna. I mean, in terms of humor, a lot of comedians have difficult lives, difficult upbringings, and sometimes tragic ends. A lot of comedians have killed themselves and had addictions. How does going through therapy and mindfulness affect your humor?
I think I got funnier because I say at the end of the show, "Do you think I'm going to lose my edge?" But I know genius comedians like Lumley or Joanna or Jennifer Saunders who are so normal they can almost bore you when they're, if you go to dinner with them. But then they're touched by genius. So I think that I'm less hectic, so I can people get the empathy. And I think when you're hectic and desperate, which Alan Rickman used to say, oh, stop it. You know, your eyes are like hatchets, meaning love me, love me. That was very unappealing, unattractive on a stage. And now I think I cool it down. I'm not so desperate. And I like to tell the story that I think I'm funnier. And I think it's more successful. You can't act 20 when you're this age.
Needs to mature. And what about the wanting to be on a stage then? So again,
Clearly, I do. Otherwise,
you're
I
on a
do not
lot of stage. I
fit.
just saw your tour schedule. It's hardcore. I mean, it'd be hardcore if you were 20. But this urge to be on a stage, to be in the spotlight, to be the center of attention, and I've heard you joke about this many times. Having had a good look at that through a therapeutic lens, where are you at with that now?
Well, it's but you know we are a bundle of contradictions. When I'm not doing that, like I went away this weekend, so I could be silent. I'm not like that in real life. So it's almost like you're feeding different sides of yourself. There was a documentary about Joan Rivers that was pathetic because it started with her saying, I want every date filled. You know, I never want to see one blank space when I'm doing my comedy. And that was just, you knew it was going to end tragically. So I'll do those shows. I like the kick, but when I'm not doing it, I'm a blank. Like nobody even, I'm not pretty, I'm nothing. And so I go back to being this kind of gormless, empty space. I'm with my, but nobody's around, or I'm just not the center of attention with my friends. Unless I'm in a really good mood, or I really love them so much, because I think making people laugh is when you love them.
It's a gift to them.
It's my present. It's like if I was great at, if it was sex, yeah, well, I think sex isn't as funny as comedy.
You make a lot of cheeky jokes about sex. Say more about that.
I don't talk about sex a lot. I talk about Ed, but I don't talk about sex. I used to in the old shows, I talk about like still being able to, I think I was pregnant and I had a cesarean, so I said I could still do my toss the ping pong ball act or something. I did use it, but I don't have it anymore. I don't know what's sexual in there. Though I am like dark, but I don't know. I would never make a pun. And I said I married Ed for length. I don't really know where that comes into this show.
Ed's your husband, right?
Yeah.
And is he sort of a balancing force for you?
Yeah, he's an anchor. I don't know why he takes this. I mean, any other man would run out of here screaming. And I say in the show that when I married him, I told him on the way down the aisle that I was how old I really was, and that I was mentally ill, and he didn't run.
He didn't run. I just hear it's just a deep admiration and love for him whenever you talk about him. I've heard you talk about him in a few interviews, and it just seems to be this appreciation for him. As you say, they're not running.
There, no, I appreciate him. I know that I take advantage of him because he's tall and he can reach a light bulb on the ceiling. But I think he's the reason I stay steady.
Nice. What do you hope people walk away with from the show? What do you hope is their feeling or thoughts as they walk out?
It's how they walk out is, I mean, I want them to say, yeah, that was me too, and I feel much better about myself, and I feel part of the community, part of the human race, because we're all the same underneath our hoods.
Okay, well, it seems like we're moving towards a sort of natural wrap up here. Anything I haven't ask you about that you don't get asked about enough in interviews that you'd love to speak about?
Camp. When I went to camp, I like to talk about the fact that I was a great canoeist, and I won an award for water skiing. I actually got into the Minocqua Bats. I was going to hold the L in the hello when the women come out on skis, and I could ski backwards and do tricks. That's all I think you missed.
The water skiing. That's I didn't get that on the Wikipedia page, so I'll we'll email
No.
them and have them at it.
Tricks. Yeah, I was a trick skier. I could jump. I think put that in. And also, don't forget to mention that I'm Not As Well As I Thought I Was is a book and a show. And
Yeah.
that's. But mommy never stops plugging.
I'll plug you one more time. So it's rubywax.net, and all her dates are on there, as well as the book, as well as if people are corporate and they want to do that, or her mindfulness course, that's all linked on rubywax.net. Ruby, any other resources we should mention at the end?
You mean that are personal or just in general?
Just stuff to find out more about you, things you've done, things that you've
Oh,
written.
all my books. Read all the books. There's seven. And, I think it's a bargain. And also, I think I describe mindfulness almost as well as, the big boys are the big boys. You go to Jon Kabat-Zinn if you want to learn about mindfulness. I'm not, fucking around. These are the big boys.
You make it accessible to people. There's people that would never read Jon Kabat-Zinn and wouldn't like his style, or professors from Oxford that do great studies and papers. But my sister read your book, and yours was the one that made sense to her.
There
So
you go, Mark.
that's
That's
not
my life.
nothing. Yeah. All right, Ruby, thank you so much. Really
Thank
appreciate it.
you.